Dear students, in this session, we will see morphology and physiology of mulberry silkworm. Silkworm, being a cold-blooded animal, duration of each life stage, growth factors, feeding schedules are completely depend on environmental factors like temperature, humidity, rainfall, light and air. Further, the insect's racial characters also play vital role to overcome all these natural hazards. However, life cycle may be delayed due to the above set factors and some may die without metamorphosis. The chromosomal studies revealed that Bombyx mori has evolved from Bombyx mandarina. The domestic silkworm has undergone a variety of genetic mutations like the ancestor silkworms. So now we will see the systematic position of Bombyx mori. It belongs to the phylum Arthropoda and class Insecta, subclass Pterycota, division Endopterycota, order Lepidoptera, superfamily Bombycoidea, and the family is Bombycidae. So you know that the scientific name is Bombyx mori. Silkworm belong to the class Insecta and phylum Arthropoda because the insect body is divided into head, thorax and abdomen. The body has specific number of segments. A typical insect has 6 segments in head, 3 in thorax and 11 in the abdomen. The head segments are completely fused during embryo stage to form a head capsule. The domestic silkworm undergoes complete metamorphosis, that is holometabola, and passes through 4 morphological stages like egg, larva, pupa and adult. The duration of each stage varies according to its inherited characters of race and according to the environmental conditions like climate during rearing and also the quality of food. The life cycle is completed in 6 to 8 weeks depending on climate and racial characters. The duration of the development stages of uni, bi and multivoltine races differs in Bombyx mori. When compare these 3, the multivoltine races has the shortest lifespan. For example, the embryonic period is 9 to 12 days, larval period is 20 to 24 days, pupal period is 10 to 12 days and the adult period is 3 to 4 days in multivoltine races. So this is very shortest when compare uni and bivoltine races. Next we will see the egg stage. So the silkworm eggs are tiny and weigh around 2000 eggs to a gram. It measures 1 to 1.3 mm in length and 0.9 to 1.2 mm in width. The weight of a single egg is about 0.5 to 0.6 mg. The size, weight, shape, color of the egg, number of eggs per laying vary among the different races and according to the season. The eggs of European races are comparatively larger and heavier. An average Indian crossbreed multivoltine races lays about 400 eggs per laying. The eggs are ovoid, ellipsoid or oval and flat on one side. This is called egg dimple. The egg color also depends upon a racial character. Races producing white cocoons lay pale yellow eggs, while yellow cocoons lay deep yellow eggs. The Japanese races lay slightly darker eggs than the Chinese races. In diapausing eggs, the egg color changes after 24 hours of egg laying and becomes dark brown or purple with deepening of the color of the seasonal pigment. But in non-hibernating eggs, the color does not change. Diapausing or hibernating eggs are called as crouidine eggs, and non-diapausing eggs are known as nomadane eggs in Japan. So far we have seen about the egg morphology, that is the color, shape and how it differs with races. Now we will see about larval morphology. The newly catched larva is black or dark brown in color and measuring about 3 mm in length. It is commonly called as ant or kigo in Japanese. The head is large and the body is densely covered with bristles. There are 4 pairs of tubercles, that is subdorsal, supraspiracular, intraspiracular and basal tubercle, each carrying 3 to 6 setae. As the larva grows by passing molt to enter into later instars, the body become smooth and light in color. This is because rapid stretching of cuticle or skin. The body has 3 divisions, that is head, thorax and abdomen. The thin elastic chitinous cuticle permits rapid growth of the larvae during any instar. The larval head consists of 6 body segments fused together with a cranium. The second, fourth, fifth and sixth segments carry appendages which are modified into antennae, mandibles, maxillae and labium respectively. Median epicranial suture is well developed and prominent in silkworm larva. Similarly, on the outside, the clypeus and the labrum are also prominent. There are 6 pairs of ocelli or larval eyes which are located behind and a little above the base of the antennae. There is a pair of antennae formed of 5 jointed segments and they are used as sensory organs. So they are otherwise called as feelers. The mouth parts include labrum, mandibles, maxillae and labium. First we will see about the labrum. This is an unsegmented projection of the anticlypeus which forms the upper lip. The next one is the mandibles. So these are generally paired appendages of the fourth cephalic segment. They are toothed and chitinized. They lie in the mouth cavity and serve to cut the mulberry leaves by a side-to-side action like the blades of a scissors. The duct of the salivary glands open at the base of the mandibles. The next one is the maxillae. These are also the paired appendages, but they are short and they are from the fifth segment of the head. Each maxillae has a basal portion made of 2 segments, the proximal caudo and the distal stipes. A maxillary lobe and a 3 segmented maxillary pulp are present on the stipes. Taste sensillae are located on this appendage. They help in the discrimination of the taste of the food. The last one is the labium. This median organ forms the lower lip. It is formed by the fusion of the appendages of the last or sixth cephalic or head segment. The caudo and stipes of the appendages of the 2 sides are fused to form 2 median structure. The lower lightly chitinized, that is known as mentum, and the upper one is heavily chitinized and black color, that is known as premontem. There is a median process in the distal end of the premontem that is called as spinneret. So this spinneret is very important one. Why? Because the silk gland opens through this opening and the silk exudes through the spinneret during the spinning of the cocoon. The labial palps are short and separate and lie on the either side of the spinneret. They are sensory in function. So now you know the location of the spinneret. Where it is located, it arises from the prementum and lie in between the labial palps. Next, we will see the thorax region of the larva. So thorax, generally it is also three segmented, that is prothorax, mesothorax and metathorax. Each of the three thoracic segments carries ventrally a pair of legs, each comprising in turn three jointed segments. These are the true legs, which are conical in shape and carry the sharp distal claws. These claws are not used for crawling, but they are used for holding mulberry leaves while feeding. Silkworm contain spiracles on the dorsal side of the mesothorax. So next segment is the abdomen. So the first one is the head, next one is the thorax, the last segment is abdomen. Here the abdomen is comprised of 11 body segments, although only 9 can be distinguished, and the last 3 are fused together to form the apparent 9th segment, the anal plate and the caudal legs. The 3rd to 6th and the last abdominal segments bear a pair of abdominal legs in each segment, which are fleshy, unjointed muscular protuberances. At the extremity, they form a sort of disc with a series of hooks inwardly curved and arranged in a semicircular fashion. On the dorsal side of the 8th abdominal segment, the larva carries the caudal horn. So this is the important identification for silkworm larva, that caudal horn. The abdominal segments carry the sexual markings, which develop distinctly in the 4th and 5th instars in the 8th and 9th segments on the ventral side. So by seeing the mark on the 8th and 9th segment, we can distinguish either it is a male or female. So what are the markings? In the female, the sexual markings appear as a pair of milky white spots in each of the 8th and 9th segments. The pair of spots on the 8th segment is known as Isiwata's foreglands, and a pair on the 9th segment is referred as Isiwata's hindgland. Isiwata's foreglands later become modified to form the bursa copulatrix and receptaculum seminis. Isiwata's hind gland become part of the posterior region of the oviduct and the accessory glands. So in the larval stage, the Isiwata's gland represented as a white milky spot on the 8th and 9th abdominal segments. Later, it is converted into reproductive part in the adult stage. Like that, in the male, a small milky white spot named Herald gland appear at the center of the ventral side between the 8th and 9th segments. It becomes the seminal duct and ejaculatory duct of the adult. So, in the female, it is Isiwata gland. In the male, it is Herald gland. On the either side of the silkworm body, there are 9 pair of spiracles placed laterally. This condition is known as peripneustic condition. So these spiracles, they are found on the thoracic segment as well as in the abdominal segments. So these spiracles are nothing but respiratory pores or breathing pores. These can be seen clearly only in the freshly molted larvae. The pupal molt occurs within the cocoon spun by the final instar larvae. So far, we have seen about the larval morphology. So, we have seen the three segment, head, thorax and abdomen, and what are all the distinguished characters present in these segments. So the next is the pupa. Pupae can be seen only by cutting open the cocoon. So cocoon is nothing but it's spun by the final instar larva. Pupae are soft and white soon after the molt, but become hard and brown with the tanning of the pupal cuticle. The color of the pupal cuticle, particularly its compound eyes and wing pads, change color with the differentiation of the adult and a rough estimate of the age of the cocoon. It can be made by a cross examination of the color of the pupae. The pupa is a non-motile and non-feeding stage. The larval organs are destroyed and adult organs are differentiated during this stage. It is divided into again the three regions, head, thorax and abdomen. The sex markings are more clearly visible than in the larva. The female pupa is larger with a broader abdomen, while male is thinly built with narrower abdomen. The female pupa can be distinguished from the male by the vertical line in the center of the 8th abdominal segment on the ventral side. In the male, there is a small round spot on the 9th segment. So, like larva, we can also distinguish male and female pupa also by observing the vertical line or spot on the pupa. Then we will move to the adult stage. What is the morphological character of the adult? So generally the adult moth emerging from the pupa is incapable to fly. It has wings, but it is not that much active. It does not feed during its short adult lifespan. The body of the moth is composed of again the three distinct segments, that is head, thorax and abdomen. The adult body surface is covered with scales. The compound eyes are situated on the either side of the head. The ocelli are absent. The antennae are conspicuous, large and bipectinate type. Morphologically, here also we can distinguish the male and female adults. The female adult has comparatively smaller antennae. Its body and the abdomen are fatter, larger, and it is generally less active than the male moth. At the caudal end, the male moth has a pair of hook that is known as hops, whereas the female moth has a knob-like projection with sensory hairs. These differences help to a large extent in separating the sexes for preparation of hybrid eggs. So, here also we can differentiate the male and female moths. So, female moth is paler, but the male moth is darker. When compare the activity, female is less active, male is more active. And the antenna is small in the case of female moth, larger in the case of male moth. And body size, that is larger in female moth and small in male moth. The typical character is the abdominal characters. So, it is large and flat with 7 segments in the case of female moth, but it is long, narrow with 8 visible segments in the case of male moth. So far, we have seen about the morphology, that is the external characters of the silkworm, egg, larva, pupa and adult. Physiology of the silkworm. Physiology, it includes the what are the system inside the silkworm, that is the digestive system, excretory system, and the special character of the silkworm is the silk gland. So now first we will see about the digestive system of silkworm. In the silkworm larva, the digestive system is more or less a straight tube from the mouth to anus, divided into 3 main parts, the foregut or stromatium, midgut or mesenteron, hindgut or proctodium. The oral aperture opens into the mouth cavity, which is followed by a narrow pharynx and esophagus. The esophagus is narrow at the anterior end and gradually widens towards the posterior end. There is a cardiac or stomatal valve at the end of the foregut, which retains the chewed mulberry leaf bits in the esophagus for some time and also prevents the regurgitation of the food from the midgut to foregut. That is, it won't allow the food from the midgut to foregut, but it allows food from foregut to midgut. The midgut is a long, wide, cylindrical tube, narrow at the posterior end. The important function of the midgut is digestion and assimilation of food. The digestive fluid, it is secreted principally from the goblet cells at the midgut epithelium, and the cylindrical cells, it absorbs the digested food. The fore and hindguts have a chitinous lining, but an inner layer of the peritrophic membrane in the midgut generally protect the midgut epithelium from mechanical damage due to the food particles. What it means, the foregut and hindgut has the chitinous lining, but the midgut has the peritrophic membrane. The hindgut consists of the small intestine, colon and rectum. Here we can see a pylorus wall near the anterior end of the small intestine, which guards and regulate the passage of digested food from the midgut to the hindgut. The hindgut is a passage for the absorption of a larger portion of food moisture and elimination of the digested food. In the anterior-posterior direction, the rectum has 6 muscles for pressing the excrements. The fecal matter is pressed in the rectum and expelled from the anus as fecal pellet bearing the hexagonal marks. In the adult, the proboscis, that is the mouth part, is vestigial as well as non-functional, and the adult does not feed. Hence, the adult digestive system appears degenerated and less prominent than the larval digestive system. So, now we have seen the digestive system of the silkworm, particularly in the larval stage. Why? Because in the adult stage, it is degenerated one. In larva only, it feed more mulberry leaves and it is very well developed in the larval stage. Next, we will see about the excretory system. The Malpighian tubules, that are the primary organs of excretion. In the larva, the Malpighian tubules arise at the junction of small intestine and colon in the hindgut of the digestive tract. So, where it is located? It is in between the midgut and hindgut. The tube arising on each side of the hindgut is enlarged into an excretory chamber from which 2 branches arise. One of the tube situated on the dorsal side again divided into 3 tubes. In all, there are 3 pair of Malpighian tubules in the silkworm larvae that stick to the midgut and run towards the anterior side, turn back and ultimately open into the rectum. What is its function? The nitrogenous compounds like protein are metabolized by these Malpighian tubules and excreted principally as uric acid. They also excrete the calcium oxalate. The Malpighian tubules in the mature larvae are light yellow and they contain large quantities of yellow vitamin B2. So, this is about the excretory system. So, the excretory system is nothing but the Malpighian tubules where the nitrogenous components are metabolized and they excreted as the uric acid. Next, we will see about the silk gland, which is the important portion of the silkworm where the silk synthesizes. So, the silk thread of the cocoon is secreted by a pair of silk gland. So, remain, there is 2 number of silk gland, which are actually a modified labial glands. Where the labium is located, it is in the mouth part. So, the silk gland also in the mouth part and it is ectodermal in origin. These dermal glands are well differentiated into in the stage of 4th and 5th instar larvae. They lie below the alimentary canal and are so large in the fully grown final instar larva that it occupies most of the body cavity ventral to the alimentary canal and accounts for about 50% of the weight of the larva. So it arises from the labial glands and it occupies the whole ventral side of the alimentary canal. The silk glands are tubular in nature and the width of the tube varies in different region of the gland. So here also the silk gland is nothing but it is a tube like structure, and here also it is differentiated into three important region, and it but the width of the different region is varies. The entire gland is formed of three layers: the outer tunica propria, which is uniform in thickness, the middle glandular layer, and the inner tunica intima. It varies with thickness. The inner tunica intima is very thick in anterior region and it is shed at each molt. In the other regions, it is thin and not shed at each molt. The number of cells in the glandular layer is fixed in the first instar larva itself. And during the growth of the gland through the different instars, there is only the growth of the cells and no increase in the cell number. The number of gland cells in the gland varies in different races. European races have the maximum number of cells. There is a gradual decrease in the number of cells in the different races in the following order: Japanese univoltine, Japanese bivoltine, Chinese bivoltine, Chinese multivoltine, and the Oriental race. The gland cells have a characteristic branched nuclei in the mature condition, but in the young worms, the nuclei are round in shape. There are three distinct regions in the silk gland, different in structure and function. They are the posterior region, middle region, and the anterior region. The posterior most region is highly folded, 15 cm in long, and it is composed of about 500 secretory cells, and they secrete the major protein of the silk, namely fibroin. So it is very important. The fibroin protein secreted from the posterior region of the silk gland. The fibroin is secreted as a precursor fibrinogen, which on extrusion from the gland becomes denatured to fibroin. The middle region is the most prominent region of the gland, 7 cm in long, and it is also the widest, and it contains 300 secretory cells. It is folded into a W-shaped structure and hence it has the three limbs: posterior, middle, and anterior limbs. In general, the silk gland, it is divided into three regions: posterior, middle, and anterior regions. Here again, the middle region, it has divided into three regions, that is posterior, middle, and anterior limbs. The middle region acts as a reservoir of the fibroin secreted by the posterior region, and fibroin matures in this region during the storage period. Here the middle region, it secreted serine 1, serine 2, and serine 3. The posterior limb of middle region secreted serine 1. Middle limb of middle region secreted serine 2. And the anterior limb of middle region secreted serine 3. So here the function of the middle region is secretion of the serine protein, which is also a important protein in silk thread. And also another function is storing and maturation of fibroin. The next region is the anterior region. So it is the uniform in thickness, 2 cm in long, and it is very very thin region. It has 250 cells with no secretory function. So this is important. So in the anterior region, no secretory functions. In middle and posterior region only, we are having the secretory function. In the anterior region, it serves only to conduct the silk fiber assembled in the middle region to the spinneret. The anterior region of the two sides open at the base of median projection in the labium called spinneret, which draws out silk in the form of a fine filament. The silk is molded to a thread as it passes through the silk press, which resembles a typical salivary pump. The threads of the two sides are called the brins, and the serosin layer of the two bind them together into a single filament, or it is otherwise called as wave. In Japan, new silkworm race which produces only serosin in the name of Serosin Hope has been developed in the year 2002 by introducing NDSD mutant. By introducing transgenes in silk gland, foreign proteins can also be synthesized. Next gland is the Flippi's gland or Leonnet's gland. This is a pair of gland situated in the head region. They open into the anterior part of the silk gland near the opening of spinneret. Its function is not established, but it is assumed that it produces a waxy material which coat the silk thread. Some consider that its secretion lubricate the tube through which silk passes. The silk filament is made up of inner fibroin, a tough elastic protein, and outer serosin, a gelatinous protein. Already we have seen that there are two proteins, fibroin and serosin, which are secreted from posterior and middle region of the silk gland respectively. So what is the contribution? The fibroin is 75% and serosin is only 25%. Serosin is insoluble in cold water and easily disposed in hot water. It has the properties of antioxidant, UV protectant, moisturizer, coagulant and chemoprotective. Fibroin has water absorbency, insulation properties, luster, thin, long, light, soft and thermotolerance. Okay, how the silk is synthesized? So the silk gland, it secretes the two proteins, fibroin and serosin. From that, how can we get the silk? When the silkworm reaches the end of the fifth instar, it secretes silk to form cocoon. The posterior region secretes liquid protein fibroin, which is dehydrated in middle region during storage. The serosin secreted by middle part covers in the form of globular pellets and it subsequently transferred forward. The forward transferred liquid silk increase its density by 30%. The thread of two sides are called brins, and the serosin layer of two binds them together into a single filament called wave before it reaches the spinneret. When this wave reaches the spinneret, through dehydration, the side chains between the fibroin molecules mutually dependent and starts crystallization. Circulation of air at this time help it to become fiber. So the globular crystals turn into fibrous crystals. So the globular crystal turn into fiber, that is the protein converted into silk fiber. So it is by atmospheric coagulation in turn into cocoon filament. The final silk thread consists of an inner silk protein fibroin surrounded by a single cementing layer of serosin, a gummy protein. Extraction of silk filament from silk glands for forming cocoon is referred as spinning. Silkworm ingest about 50 gram of mulberry leaf per larva, and above 60% of the nitrogen contained in the mulberry leaves are used for silk protein synthesis. Each larva can produce about 0.6 gram of silk protein. It consists of 80%. So already we have seen the 75, that is nearly 80% of the fibroin and 20% of the serosin. So here the spinning is completed in 48 to 72 hours. that is after the larva attaining the late instar, from the 48 to 72 hours, it spin the cocoon and it complete. So far, we have seen about the what are the morphological characters and the physiology of silkworm.